Greetings and welcome. This is your Polish-American Connection television show, and I'm your host, Tom Gajewski. Tonight we have a very different and very interesting show for you. I think you'll agree once you see it. As you know, in the past we've tried to feature prominent members of the Polish community who have achieved good things in our community, and tonight's guest is certainly no exception to that. Just a couple of reminders before we get started. As always, we ask you to keep a pencil and paper nearby, because at the end of the show we'll be going through some announcements of some upcoming events that you might want to note, particularly the dates and who you contact if you're interested in attending. So please get those ready, and we'll go over those things at the end of the show. Now on to our special guest, and let me say a few words about him. He's really made a significant contribution to not only the Polish community, but to the Berks County community as a whole. Many Berks Countyans have benefited from the things that he's done, and I'm proud to say that I'm one of them. He operated on my wrist and did a great job. I'm even able to do push-ups. So. Thank you very much, Doctor. I appreciate that.
You're quite welcome.
And he's also got a skill tonight that might not be known to many of you. Besides his skills in the medical field, he's able to do quite a job with woodworking. In fact, I was surprised to learn that one time he considered going into cabinet making. Fortunately for us, he chose to go into medicine because, again, so many people have benefited from that. He's an orthopedic surgeon. He's a partner in Commonwealth Orthopedics. He's operated and, as I say, helped really literally thousands of Berks Countyans. And he'll be talking about his hobby, which requires very special skills. And with that, I'm proud to welcome Dr. John Stelmach to our program. Dr. Stelmach.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for having me. It's certainly wonderful to be here and hearing all those wonderful compliments. My goodness, I'm going to blush right away.
But thank you very much for being here. I'm sure the people will enjoy what you have to say. Why don't we get started by just asking you the name Stelmach. I thought it was German.
Right.
You want to tell us a little bit about your family?
That's a pretty common thing, especially being in Pennsylvania, Dutch country. I think Stelmach is a German name, but it's actually Polish. It did start in Germany in the early 100s or something. It was Stelmacher, and then people immigrated to Poland and became Stelmach. And actually, Stelmach in Polish is actually in the Polish dictionary, means cartwright or wheelwright. So,
and you're 100% Polish.
100% Polish.
So you're part of a rare breed these days.
It's getting rarer and rarer, at least the United States. So.
And how long have you been an orthopedic surgeon?
I came back to Reading after I finished my training, and that was in 1993 in January. So I'm starting my 20th year here in Reading, which is really hard to believe.
Let's try to nail down the number a little bit. How many surgeries have you performed?
Well, I specialize in hip and knee replacement, and I calculate I've probably done about 7,000 to 8,000 of those surgeries in the 20 years I've been here, so it's a lot.
Wow.
It's a sovereign center full. which is hard to believe.
There's a lot of people walking around and doing things because of your work.
Well, so it's nice.
Thank you for that.
You're quite welcome.
You also, I believe, taught some classes at the Goggle Works, didn't you?
Yes, I taught some classes in woodworking at the Goggle Works. I taught how to carve bong claw feet and how to make something called a cabriolet leg, which we'll get into in a little bit here, but I was able to teach that for a few years. Recently I've been a little bit busier, but plan to get back to that shortly.
I think you brought some samples and some slides that you'd like to share with the people.
Yes, I did. I can show some examples of what a ball and claw foot is, which is an interesting type of leg that's on a piece of furniture. That's really from the colonial period, from about 1700 was when they started, to fairly popular through the early 19th century, in 1820s or so. Mm-hmm. And it's very interesting with that, but I can show some examples here. This is something I'm currently working on. I have a few projects that are in the mothballs, but I'm working on this one currently. But this is called a cabriolet leg here. And what this is, it refers to the shape of the leg. It's sort of that lazy S curve that's on the leg. When you look at it from the front, it looks straight, but from the side, it does have some curves. And what happens with this, this is from the Chippendale period, and the foot of the ball and claw is the part that was particular to this part of Pennsylvania and along the colonial areas up to New England. And what this shows, what it looks like and what it actually is, it came from Chinese, and it actually symbolizes a dragon picking up the pearl of wisdom, is what it's supposed to be. And this is a very popular style. And it's very interesting with how these different styles got started. Like this area of the country has this particular style, and New England has a little bit different style, because the craftsmen were very interested in making furniture and making a living at it. So they had to learn how to make them, and the master taught the apprentice, who learned everything he could, then he opened his own shop, and he certainly was not going to make something different at that point. Mm-hmm. So they actually just copied what their master made, but they stayed very regional because we didn't have I-95 to get from Philadelphia to Boston too easily at that point.
How long does it take to make something like that?
Well, the first time I made one, I got a video and worked on it, and I think it took me about 2 weeks. But I was able to get it finished. First one you do is the hardest. So after about 2 weeks, I realized that, well, I got through it, but maybe I should take a course. And then I went up to above Massachusetts to above Salem, Massachusetts, and there's a course there, and I took and learned from a master carpenter who actually analyzed and looked at these ball and claw feet and thought, well, how did they actually make these? And they had to make them quickly and kind of retro-engineered them and kind of learned the techniques backwards to figure out how to do them quickly. And once you learn how to do it, the actual part of the foot, I can do it in about 45 minutes getting it roughed out to look to this condition, but then you have to shape it and smooth it and things, and that takes a little bit of time.
Mm-hmm. It really looks intricate, like there's a lot of time that you have to spend to get it just right.
There is, and like anything, you know, once you can imagine within a piece of wood what's there, then it's a lot easier to get it out of the wood. When you first start, you really don't understand what you're doing, mm-hmm. but then after you learn about it, then you can see it actually in the wood, you know what to take out. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting how that works. And a lot of times when I started with this, you'd grab a tennis ball and hold on to it, and I'd be looking at it, trying to figure it out. Okay, now this goes, which way does it go? It could be very confusing, but it really looks fantastic, and I don't really think a piece of furniture looks right unless it has that on. So it's what your eye appreciates, and that's so much of everything.
Sure. And you have some other interesting pieces there, I believe.
Yep. With this one here, this shows what's called an acanthus leaf on the front, and this is almost finished, but an acanthus leaf is actually something that's over in Europe, and a lot of Roman architecture has an acanthus leaf on it, and it's sort of a three-pronged leaf that goes down. And in Pennsylvania, that was something that they put on a lot of the decorative part of the furniture, because this is really just a table leg is what it is. It's just very decorative. Once you have the basics of it designed, it's just decoration and everything after that. So they decorate it with a leaf pattern. In New England, where I took my course, they were in the ocean, and they were very intimately involved with the sea, and they saw a lot of seashells. So in New England, instead of having the acanthus leaf, which is like this, they would often put a shell in the front. And the shell pattern, they would just take a scallop shell like this. This doesn't get put on here. You have to actually carve this in here. And I always like to tease our instructor that it's much easier to make a shell than it is the acanthus leaf. So I think in Pennsylvania they're a little bit more advanced, but we didn't necessarily agree on that. But it was certainly fun for some discussion. But when you look at this ball and claw kind of foot that I have in this cabriolet leg, I just brought a few examples of some things that I made. What happens is that this basic shape can be translated into many different pieces of furniture depending on what the needs are. So the basic shape, you can go from a very short, this is a sample, but before I make any piece of furniture, you have to make a practice piece, because you have to know what you're doing and learn the pitfalls before you go to do it. You have to practice the operation before you do it. So this shows a very short leg, and this is on meant for like a chest of drawers, very low. And there's another examples here, and this is just, again, another practice piece, because it's a little hard to bring the full-size furniture into town here. But this is the same size as this one, which is a standard 17-inch, but this is meant for like what's called a low boy. This would attach to the drawers and the rails for that. And then this is the same basic shape, But this is one that's even longer, but the same basic idea. This is for a table I made for my son. So, but that, again, that's the practice piece. And this is a local wood called poplar, which is used for a lot of practice pieces. It's relatively inexpensive.
By the way, for our viewers, if you have any questions for Dr. Stelmach, please give us a call at 610-378-0426.
And one other thing that's interesting with the wood, people often tell you, you know, when I show them the things that I've made, they say, oh, gee, that's mahogany, which is what a lot of the artists in the 1700s worked with. And so, oh, that's a hard wood. That must be very hard to work with. Mm. And the real truth about it is it's probably the easiest wood to carve that there is. It's very smooth grained. It's very even. And it just carves beautifully. And when you cut it with a chisel, a carving tool, it just leaves a perfectly smooth surface. So in actuality, that's why they used it. Mm. And plus, it's a very beautiful wood, of course. Poplar, this wood here, the reason they don't carve much out of that, it's a very fibrous wood. And when you carve it with a chisel, it'll often leave like little hairs, which in the old days, they didn't have sandpaper. Mm. So they had to do everything by hand. So it made for quite a bit of work. And the other thing I think is a little bit interesting as well with what they did was they didn't have a lot of money and tools were very, very expensive. So in order to carve this foot here, you think you'd need 10,000 different tools, but you really don't. What you do, I have these tools here. I have five tools that are used to carve this whole foot. That's all that's used because they didn't have a lot of money, and the more tools you use, the more expense you had to do, and the tools get dull, so the more things you had to sharpen, which is a very big thing. So when you see a tool like this, when they design things, they actually design that this tool has a curve on it which perfectly matches the actual ball of the foot, so you can carve that out with that.
We do have a home viewer, Doctor.
Good.
Go ahead, home viewer. Hello.
Hello, Tom. This is Roy. How you doing?
Good. How are you, Roy?
I'm fine, and I have a question for the doctor.
Sure.
When did you become interested in this woodworking and making furniture and things like that? Was it in childhood because of the Boy Scouts or something like that? What was it?
Really, it's from my childhood. My father was one of those guys that said, well, if it's broken, well, we're going to give it a try and see if we can fix it. So he's very, wanted to try everything at home, and I liked that. And then I found gradually I liked to work with the wood, and I was always very interested how things were constructed and how they were put together. It just, my eye would catch that. So like Tom said, when in high school, I really was considering becoming a cabinet maker, or woodworker, or something, but I chose medicine. I thought it might be a little bit better of a job.
Do you have a lot of homemade furniture in your home?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. We'll be showing some examples of that here in a minute, but I do have a lot of things that I've made at home and have at home. In fact, I'm getting too many, so my children are getting to the age where they're starting to scavenge them, which is fine.
Well, it's a very interesting guest, Tom. Thanks for having him on.
Our pleasure, and we're grateful to him that he was able to do it. By the way, let me just add a note to that, to what you referred to there, Roy. I thought when I called Dr. Stelmach's office that I'd be waiting several days for a response, but I left a brief message, and would you believe inside of 2 hours I got a call back, which totally amazed me. So
I have a good staff that brought it to my attention.
So. It must not have been a Wednesday.
Nope.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Roy. Appreciate the call.
I guess maybe we could show some of the things I've made with the slides, maybe. If they can cue them up, I can describe a little bit what I had made, if they can show one.
Okay.
This is a desk I made. Actually, this is a reproduction desk from a doctor who actually practiced in Germantown. There was a guy named Frank Gottschall who was a woodshop teacher in Boyertown, and he wrote a book on antique reproductions and actually did some intricate schematic drawings of them, so it was fairly, not simple, but he left a lot of the how to put a piece together. So this is out of his book, and that's called a partner's desk. Mm. It is actually the same on both sides.
It's a beautiful piece.
Thank you. And has the cabriolet legs and has the acanthus leaf carving, and the molding that's on the edge of the table is interesting. And I don't know where the name comes from, but that's called gadrooning, G-A-D-R-O-O-N, gadroon molding. That was interesting to have to carve that. It's a pretty big top, and getting around that, I Thank God I'm an orthopedic surgeon. I could prescribe my own anti-inflammatory after I did that. But and then the front of the desk is carved, and it's curved. You can't really see it that well there, but that was one of those pieces when I got done. I was like, holy mackerel, I can't believe I built that. So
is that cherry wood?
That's all mahogany. That's the mahogany. Okay. Yep, it's mahogany. And the one thing that's nice about building your own furniture, you can splurge in the wood a little bit, because the labor is often the most expensive part. So. But that's actually in my office over my wine missing office, and I'm pretty proud of it. So,
how long did it take you to do that?
When I start working on something like that, I get kind of in a frenzy. That took about 3 months. I wind up working just on the weekends, like 48 hours on the weekends and at night. So I get kind of attack it. So because I have that thought in my brain, I can't let it get out of there because I'll forget what I'm doing. So I guess there's maybe another slide there. We can show something else. This is a Pennsylvania high boy. This is also out of Mr. Gottschall's book. This has the cabriolet legs. These are the first real piece ones that I made. These are the ones that took 2 weeks a piece. So this took a little bit longer. And this one has a lot of carving on the front of the cabinet work. And this has some quarter columns on the side, which I had to learn how to make, which were very interesting. This is, again, also the mahogany. And one interesting fact, that one of my former high school principal, Dr. Flannery, actually was a principal for this Frank Gottschall, and I she read this guy's books. It was actually very, very detailed with his books, so he must have been a good woodshop teacher. The kids probably hated him, but he was very interesting. We have the next slide there? Okay. This is a grandfather's clock I made, and it's a composite of a bunch of clocks. I went over to a historical society and looked through their collection of tall case clocks. It's not really grandfather clock they're called. They're tall case clocks. And looked at the different cabinet styles and that sort of thing. And luckily I ran into a patient over there. Said, oh, sure, come on, doc. Look at me. He gave me a book about all the clocks. It's funny that where your perspective on many things comes from. When I thought of the clockmaker, I was thinking the guy who made the cabinet. Hmm. But when you talk about the clockmaker, it was the guy who made the clock parts, which is absolutely nothing that I'm interested in. Mm-hmm. So, actually, the guy who made the cabinet was just some schlub that got to make the cabinet, and the clockmaker was the guy who made the actual mechanism, which is really the intricate part in the 1700s. And the famous guy around here was Rose, was his last name. I'm going to say Charlie Rose, but I think it's a talk show host. I'm not sure what his first name was, but Rose
another
was the guy.
Another Charlie, maybe.
Yeah, but that was his name. So, and that was this is made out of curly maple, which is also sometimes called tiger maple, and has the striping to it. And certain maple boards trees will actually have this striping, and it's very dramatic. It's really a pretty wood. And luckily, right at this time, an article in Fine Woodworking came out on how to pop the curl and curly maple. So it's pretty dramatic. It's a nice piece, and we enjoy it today.
Yeah, you can see the grain. That's really nice.
And this is a slant top desk I made. This was from a different a book that I had read, and it was a book that gave you just the basics of it. And this is also made out of mahogany, and there you can't really see it here, but there's inlay along the center drawer. A center doorway with what's called zebra wood, which actually does come from Africa. It's a white and striped wood. It's used for inlay a lot. Yeah. And it was interesting making a slant top desk because that slant, that's the top that closes, isn't that straightforward to make, as I learned as I was going through it. But somehow, a lot of times when you're doing a project like this, you just have to make it work. Mm-hmm. You have a problem, you have to look at it and just, well, how am I going to get it to fix? Sometimes you just get the unavoided problem. And you just have to just go through it. So,
okay, if we could, before we go on to the next part, we'd like to take a brief break for BCTV to make an announcement.
You're watching the Polish-American Connection on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local heritage societies and local history, go to bctv.org.
I'd like to thank BCTV for providing this kind of programming and providing the opportunity to the Polish American community And also like to tell our viewers that if you're interested in seeing this program, this is repeated several times, and you can check on the schedule for that. And you can also go to bctv.org for this program and any other program that BCTV produces and plays here. So, Doctor, please continue.
Sure. While we're making plugs, I have to plug everybody to go down to the wood shop at Gog Wars, because it is a wonderful resource in town. And some folks don't know, you can purchase open shop time there, and I do spend some time down there. Mm. There are certain tools you can use the shop and with some instruction, and there's lots of tools, and you can do all this stuff down there. It's a great resource. I guess maybe the one thing I'll show here, this is from that high boy I made. This is an example. I'm actually making a coffee table with this. So this is something that they would have done years ago. They would have had a pattern that they had of a design and then used that for different pieces in order to save a little bit of time so you don't have to reinvent the wheel every time that you do it. But this would be the what they call the rail of the coffee table, and this is what's called a tenon here, and this goes into a slot into the leg, and it's called a mortise and tenon joint. And this really dates back even to the Egyptians, but these fit together here like this, and that would actually make the leg. Mm. And that would make the leg in order to, then you complete this. So this is getting close. And a funny story about these legs here, I'll get this apart here, but when you make these legs, they usually don't have any sides on them. As you can see from this example, these pieces here are called the transition piece, and this is flat here, there's nothing here, so this has to be installed. And funny how you learn how to do things. When I made the high boy, it literally took me 2 weeks of thinking how to put these on. When I went to Massachusetts and learned from the guy who knew how to do it, he said, oh, that's easy. All he did was smooth it out and just rubbed it with glue and stuck it on, and he had done 2 minutes. And I spent 2 weeks. So it's amazing if you know what you're doing, how much easier things go. So, but it's great to have it. That hobby passed on, and those resources are out there to go to some courses, and the Gog Works, you can learn things like that too. But a lot of this stuff, as I tell people when I taught classes, don't worry about it. If it doesn't come out right, only you're going to be the one that's going to see it. You just get it finished, and your next one's going to be better. Don't dwell and try to make it perfect, because I can guarantee you nothing's perfect.
I think we can see from the work that Dr. Stelmach does that he could have been successful in woodworking as well, in cabinet making. So, again, thanks very much for being here.
You're quite welcome. It was a pleasure.
My pleasure, really. And you can see he's a nice guy besides. I'd like to go to our announcements, if we may. Polish-American Heritage Association Cultural Room. We've talked about this before, and unfortunately there was an error on this typed form, so it had to be corrected in printed form, and my printing is not the greatest, but that's located at the Goggle Works on the fifth floor, 2nd and Washington Streets in Reading, Pennsylvania, and it's open Saturday and Sunday from 12 to 4 p.m., and there's free admission. You can park for free in the rear of the building, and there's now a new display. Henry Prusky is involved in kind of overseeing the operation there, and I was at the last meeting of this group, and he talked about the new display. So I'm not going to tell you what it is. If you want to know what it is, you need to get down there to see it. Can we have the next one? I want to mention to you that there are three polka shows that you can listen to on the radio. First of all, on Saturday morning from 9 to 10 a.m., Janet and John Osuch are on WBZH. You might remember that as WPAZ in Pottstown, 1370 a.m. They're back on the air, and they're also on the Internet at WBZH.net. And then on Sunday from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., Walter Kay's Polka Party with John Bruschak is on WRAW, 1340 a.m., and it's also on the Internet at 1340WRAW.com. And then finally on Sunday from 10 a.m. to noon, Kaz's German-Bavarian Polka Show on WEEU 830 a.m. Reading. The Polish-American Heritage Association has its April monthly meeting on Sunday, April 20th at 2 p.m., room 325 in the Goggle Works, 2nd and Washington Streets. There's free parking in the rear of the building. And guests are welcome, and you ought to really, if you're interested in what what's happening in the Polish community. It's a meeting you ought to go to because there's a lot of good things happening, and they're open to new ideas. The 67th annual scholarship dinner, and get this, there'll be 13 scholarships given out, and they will total $24,000. And that will take place at the Reading Country Club on Sunday, April 29th. 4 o'clock starts the social hour, and then dinner will be served at 5. And for $30, you can have your choice of veal marsala or crab cakes. And for information, or if you want to send in your money, you can do that to Helen Novotarski at 1076 Freemansville Road, Shillington, Pennsylvania, 19607, 610-777-4598. And I might suggest that if you send the money in and without calling her, that you put your phone number on there so that she can contact you if there's any question. Then we have the Polish Open at Green Acres Golf Course in Burnville. It's a noon shotgun start, and there's $1,000 in cash prizes to the first golfer with a hole-in-one, and that's, again, there's two of those. And for $65, you'll get a cart, you'll get lunch, hot dogs, and sauerkraut, and then there's a great Polish buffet with kielbasa, gołębki, cucumber salad, and chruszczyki. Advanced registration is required by May 14th, and you can sponsor a hole for $50. Call Marilyn at 610-779-5523. Okay, I'd like to thank again Dr. Stelmach for being here. I appreciate it very much.
You're quite welcome.
And I'd like to thank our viewers, thank Roy for calling in tonight, and to all of you, please take care, and until the first Tuesday in May, take care of yourself, God bless you, and always be proud to be Polish.